Welcome to Frank Buckley Interviews. Tonight our guest is Justin Woolverton, the guy who came up with this stuff, Halo Top Ice Cream.
Frank Buckley Interviews starts now.
Justin was a lawyer at a big city firm who realized he didn't want to be a lawyer, and so began a quest to create the perfect ice cream. And in a few short years, Halo Top became America's number one pint at the grocery store. But first, he would go deep into debt, make a bunch of mistakes, and nearly destroy the pipes at a local manufacturing facility.
And when it's pasteurizing, it goes through these aluminum tubes that's kind of the size of a baseball bat. And every segment has the bolts. And it's like a submarine, like incoming torpedo. Like there's red lights flashing when we run this thing. There's like a, you know, it's going to blow this thing going. And sure enough, we're sitting there and we're basically ducking for cover because these bolts are flying across the room.
Man.
Just crazy.
Justin Woolverton and the amazing success of Halo Top Creamery when we come back. Justin, welcome.
Thanks for having me.
You know, I've been wanting to talk to you for a long time, not because I'm a huge fan of Halo Top. I actually haven't tried it.
Mm-hmm. We'll fix that.
Yeah. But because I'm a sucker for a success story,
mm-hmm.
and you've had amazing success. And to put it into perspective, you're number one now
mm-hmm.
in the, what is the category?
So to be fair, it fluctuates.
Okay.
So it's pretty much at the top. It's Haagen-Dazs, Ben & Jerry's, and Halo Top. Last year, we did for a month or two become the number one pint. And then what was really cool was after that, we became the number one brand. And so the difference between that is, for example, you know, Ben & Jerry's are just pints. But then
yeah.
you have a brand like Breyers that has pints and quarts and
yeah.
gallons and all of this. So becoming the biggest brand was kind of cooler than becoming the biggest pint.
And you, so folks know your background. You're not from some ice cream family.
Not at all. I mean, we made homemade ice cream out on the deck, which was
right.
always a good memory. But no experience whatsoever.
You were a lawyer.
I was a lawyer, yep, here
and
at an LA firm.
You were a lawyer and realized, wow, I'm going to be doing this kind of work for the rest of my life, and that's not what I want to be doing.
Yeah, for me, it was when you start, what they call it, quote-unquote, big law, which is these really big firms that represent the biggest clients and all this stuff. And the upside is, it's a pretty good paycheck. The downside is it's a little, miserable. I'm trying to look for a milder word, but... the way it works is when you start, you're doing things like doc review and this really, you know, this stuff that's just kind of a trudge.
Yeah.
And you always have this light at the end of the tunnel that, you know, you put in your work for 3 years and then eventually things get better. You're supervising cases. And I was kind of thinking that myself, maybe deluding myself a little bit. And I got this one case with this great partner. I was sent to Hong Kong. It's very cool. Nice hotel. I flew business class for the first time. But what I'm getting at here is... I was still in my room at this nice hotel just doing stacks of paperwork all night, not even being able to see Hong Kong, really.
Oh.
And that was when I kind of realized this is as good as it gets, and that's a very bad sign. So
yeah.
at that point, I was like, okay, I gotta transition a little bit here.
And you decided to transition to ice cream right then, or was it,
no,
what am I going to do?
No, I had a little bit of a crisis, and believe it or not, there was a little period where I did like the LA thing. I started writing scripts, and I did some stand-up, and I... took some improv classes, and I was going that route. And I think I did about 9 stand-up shows before realizing I just sucked. So I was like, well, let's find something else here. In the meantime, I was making this concoction that would become Halo Top. My issue is I can't eat sugar a lot, so that was kind of the genesis of it. So I was basically freezing something like Greek yogurt, adding stevia. You know what stevia is?
Uh-huh, yeah.
Add some fruit and just blend it and stick it in the freezer, total bachelor style. And, you know, I'd go out or something, come home, and at least it was frozen. And then the eureka moment once was, for some reason, you go on Amazon, and it gives you the suggested products or whatever. For some reason, I saw an ice cream maker, and I was like, hey, I make that stuff. Why don't I just order this thing to my house? Ran my little blended concoction in that. It turned out to be really good, and that was just kind of the eureka moment of, I'm going to, let's run with this.
And do you take it to someone and say, hey, what do you think, or do you... What's
so,
the next step?
So from there, it was a ton of R&D. It took a year of getting this right, because when you make it in your home kitchen, then you go to a factory and you're making, let's say, 100 pints at a time. That's actually a small amount in this world, but at the time it was, whoa, 100 pints. The equipment is completely different. The composition of the ice cream mix has to completely change. You know, I went up there with, you know, 3 ingredients and ran it in this machine, and it was just a complete failure. It was demoralizing for a couple days, but you learn, and through that it's trial and error and R&D and figuring out, you know, how to make this stuff. There wasn't any precedent because the stuff had never been made before. So there were a lot of, you know, you can't do this, kid, that type of stuff too. And I was like, right. Well, okay.
And at some point you decide to take on a partner.
Yes. So in 2013, my business partner, Doug, came on board. This is interesting. He was doing a different food company, a beverage company, actually. You can tell this guy's a genius and his work ethic is ridiculous.
And when do you finally get to sell this stuff? And who is the first?
So that was 2012. And the first was Erewhon. Do you know what Erewhon is?
Yeah, sure do.
Yeah, and I happened to live two blocks from there at the time. But I went down there with my little cooler. You know, you take it down there literally in a cooler, like a lunch pail, and met the buyer. And, you know, you don't know, as a complete rookie, you don't know how to even call a store and be like, how do I sell my product at your store? And they're like, oh, the buyer meets every Thursday. And there was a lady named Vicky at Erewhon. And when I'm making my first call, I'm nervous. You know, probably my voice is shaking. I'm like, hi, I made this thing. And she, you know, was so good and just so used to awkward first calls that she just basically walked me through it and was great. Went down there and they took it like a week later.
A week later?
Yeah. I was like, wow, this is cool. It's on a shelf. Crazy.
And so you immediately gear up and you have to go into production and you're ready to do that.
Well, at Erewhon... when you're doing that, you're not moving much product. So I could still make it. At the time, I was making it on the machines that could make about 100 pints. Mm. And that was plenty at that time. It wasn't until, 2013 that we got our first like national account and then had to step up, change factories to place with much bigger equipment.
And how does that happen? How do you go from Erewhon 100 pints at a time to that next step?
It's tough. So you're sitting there in a buyer meeting. And it's a great opportunity. They're like, we'll take you nationwide in 200 stores. And they're like, can you make it? And deep down, you know, I can make 100 pints. So you just sit there with all the confidence in the world. And you're like, yes, of course. If we have capacity, I can make 1,000,000 pints right now. And then they're like, okay, we need it in 2 months. And you're like, sounds good. Okay, we'll do that right now. And so then it's just a rush, you know, no sleep, finding a factory. And every time we tried to find a factory, there was always these funny stories. When we upgraded to this bigger factory, this mix had never been done before, and it has a higher protein content. And what that means is it's thicker. And
adds the viscosity.
Viscosity.
Right.
Great term. I don't know if you know how ice cream is made, but before it's run through the machines, it's basically got the consistency of kind of milk. And then you run in the machines, it freezes, and you get hard ice cream. And so our milk was a little bit, you know, had higher viscosity. And so none of the factories would take it. They're like, it's not going to run on our machines.
And you're telling them, look, I'm going into 200 stores.
They still don't want to do it. Of course it's going to work. I have no idea if it's going to work. Of course it's going to work. And luckily we found a partner and they were willing to take a chance. And they were like, we're nervous it's going to break our pipes, but we're going to take a chance. And sure enough, we go down there. We're like, no, this is going to be just fine. We run it through their equipment. And when it's pasteurizing, it goes through these aluminum tubes. It's kind of the size of a baseball bat. And every segment has the bolts. And it's like a submarine, like incoming torpedo. Like there's red lights flashing when we run this thing. There's like a, you know, it's going to blow this thing going. And sure enough, we're sitting there and we're basically ducking for cover because these bolts are flying across the room.
Man.
Just crazy. And so, you know, it was embarrassing. Like, sure enough, you said it probably wouldn't work, and it didn't work. So from there, it was a struggle to get the viscosity down and to convince them, hey, give us another shot. Here's proof the viscosity is down. Here, take a look. And so it finally worked out.
Oh, man.
Yeah.
Even before that, there is a moment where you guys are hundreds of thousands of dollars in debt.
Absolutely.
You're not in 200 stores. You're trying to figure out if you've really got a business here.
Yep.
You obviously believe in the product, but so many other entrepreneurs have been in that spot.
Mm-hmm.
I know I've got a good thing here. I know that I can sell this if people will just give me a chance, if they'll just try it. But then the debt, all of it,
yep.
that's sort of the moment where they give up.
Yeah, yeah.
Why didn't you give up?
I believed in the product. I really thought that there was a market for it. I was looking at things like Greek yogurt and Chobani, and I was like, you know, it just doesn't make sense. There's something wrong here. And so maybe there was a period I would have given up, but there was also kind of a come to Jesus moment where it was like, look, we're not doing what we should be doing, and I think this should work, and it's not. So what is happening here? And so we made some changes in 2015, and sure enough, that was what it took to get it to pop.
And, well, tell me about it. What happened in 2015? So
this is a funny story. In 2015, we were deeply in debt. I'd spent $100,000 of my own cash. That was a good part about being a lawyer, is you had some cash. And then $150,000 in credit card debt. I know my credit card companies were like, oh my goodness, what did we do? And so my credit score was horrible, like in the 500s at that point.
Oh, wow.
And, you know, I was missing some payments and stuff like that. And Doug and I took out basically predatory loans. You know those companies that yes. charge you 43% interest? So Doug takes it out for $20,000. At the time, that would give us a float for, you know, 2, 3, 4 months. And then I wanted to take mine out, and they denied me. The predatory loan company denied me. It's like, okay, this is rock bottom. So other than that, it was stressful. It was. I wouldn't wish that on my worst enemy, to be honest. A lot of sleepless nights and a lot of, oh, man, did I just waste 4 years of my life and stuff like that.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And but somehow you got through it, and you said that there was something that had to change. Mm-hmm. So what was it?
It was two things, really. What was happening was it was really good. The ice cream was really good off the line. Like at the factory. And that was something that was really confusing to us, is this stuff is healthy and it tastes good. Why is this not resonating? And what would happen is it goes through the supply chain, and altitude affects the ice cream's, let's say, consistency, you know? So by the time it reached the end consumer, it would be frostbitten, it would have shrunk, it'd lose air, just weird things had happened to it. And so I created this, but I had to swallow my pride, and I went up and worked with a dairy scientist, which was actually cool as an ice cream nerd at this point. It was the first time I could nerd out on in terms of composition of ice cream.
Right.
Up in Cal Poly, San Luis Obispo, I won't say slow.
Right.
Yeah. And that was fun. They actually have a dairy science department. I didn't even realize those existed. But you go in, everybody's just talking about dairy and cheese and this, and you know, you park by cows, which was cool. And so I worked with him a little bit. He had experience with ice cream. He had experience with frozen yogurt. And we helped make it more resilient. Didn't really change the taste, just made it more resilient. Mm-hmm. That was the first thing. So it just tasted better. So the person who bought it was more likely to buy it again and tell their friends this, that, and the other. And the second thing is we got a cease and desist letter on our packaging. And that was a blessing in disguise because in retrospect, our packaging wasn't the most beautiful. And so that cease and desist gave us an opportunity. And they were right, by the way. When they pointed out, we were like, okay, yeah, we've got no argument.
Because you were using a trademark name.
It was actually the dress. It was the logo. It was Halo Top, but it was in a certain logo that infringed on a certain tea company that was huge. And so, you know, we instantly caved and used that as an opportunity to redesign the packaging. Packaging was too busy. There's a lot of attributes to Halo Top that make it good. Protein, low sugar, all natural, this type of stuff. And so if you try to say everything, you say nothing. And so we cut the clutter. Calories was front and center. That's what people mostly care about, you know. And we thought our second best selling point was protein. So we just put both of those on the front. Calories front and center, large, and better colors, all that stuff. And the reason that that's really important is because that's your number one billboard. Is people walking along the aisle and seeing it on the shelf. That's more valuable than any billboard in the world, you know? And so finally we were jumping off. We looked a lot different than other packaging, jumping off, popping off, popping, getting their attention. And now it's pretty Instagram worthy and pretty good looking.
And I was just wondering, is that crucial today to success, to have that sort of social media component?
Absolutely. I would say two things. People like to share it. And obviously, you know, it's word of mouth amplified. It's not just telling a friend. You can tell all your followers. And then the second thing is advertising on Instagram, especially when you're kind of a bootstrap company and you don't have that many dollars. You're in a store and you can take $30 and target everybody in a 5-mile radius who shopped at that store, who might have liked ice cream before.
Yeah, let's talk about Scoop Shop. Now you've got two brick-and-mortar shops here in Southern California.
Yep.
And that's a sort of a risky thing, right? Because mm-hmm. now you're investing in real, not just product, but uh-huh. in paying rent.
So it's actually fun to learn a new business. You know, I feel like I'm more of an entrepreneur than a, let's say, CEO. I wouldn't want to run some gigantic conglomerate. You know, it's more fun to learn about a new business and see how it works. And it was a learning process for sure. But actually, in the early days, before I even launched the thing and took it to a supermarket, there was a question of, is this going to be better suited for a grocery store, or is it going to be better suited for retail? Because on one hand, you know, grocery stores are a bigger opportunity, but it was a tougher sell. Kind of a, you know, low calorie, high protein ice cream. Who knew if anybody would like that at Ralph's, for example, or, you know, Kroger. Whereas, let's say something like a Pinkberry, the pump was already primed for that being healthy and having a health halo. So if we could go into just do retail and take on the Pinkberries and say, look, they're synthetic, we're all natural, they're all sugar, we're very low sugar, you know, we're higher in protein, they don't have any protein. I thought that would really resonate, but just a smaller opportunity. So there was a point there where, you know, we almost started with retail, but we didn't. It worked out. And then the dream was always to one day open some retail shops for just a different Halo Top experience.
And now look at you.
Hey, credit score's up. Yeah, I two funny things that, you know, I'm not very money motivated, but paying off student loans and, you know, having my credit cards back to zero, everything else to me is just gravy.
Yeah.
Really?
And is it gratifying, both on the financial level and your credit score, but also just as someone who had an idea and who literally cooked it up in his kitchen, and now you're selling to people all over the country and in the UK and where else overseas?
Australia, Ireland, Canada, Mexico.
Interestingly. I mean, that must just be, do you pinch yourself?
It's surreal, really. It's just surreal that, in, you know, we're at a point now where we go into different markets and people are scared of us that we never would have imagined that we're scared of us, if that makes sense. And it all happens so quick that honestly, yeah, it feels really good, honestly, but it's also, it's surreal. It's just like, I never imagined this would happen, but hey, great.
And you're even a sort of a pop culture sort of a phenomenon. I mean, I think, you know, there are references to you in pop culture. The, as you said, you're on social media all over the place. It's not just, oh, it's another food product that I'm going to eat today. It's it's part of the conversation.
Yeah, well, I think it was made at the right place, the right time, all of that. It was just what you called market fit. And I know the feeling of when you eat a certain way, you're so grateful when a food or something comes out that helps you live that way. And there, at the time, there weren't many products like this. So for me, that's how I eat Halo Top. I didn't create Halo Top to take it to market. I created Halo Top for myself.
Yeah. To those entrepreneurs who are out there watching you and thinking, gosh, I want to be Justin.
Yeah.
I want to do that myself. Are there some sort of common sort of points of advice that you can give to that person watching?
Boy, for me, I've always been skeptical of the business school approach where you do case studies because everything to me is so contextual. Somebody could come along with the exact same product as Halo Top. They could have done it a year after we did, and the market is so different constantly, and you're going to have to deal with different struggles that I guess I would just say know your strengths and know your weaknesses. Get help with your weaknesses. Be brutally honest with yourself. And most of all, just be flexible because you're going to be demoralized. There's a roller coaster up and down. You have to be resilient. And if you can't, if you're not ready for the roller coaster, then you're in the wrong game because there are going to be periods where you're in a dark place.
And it sounds like you also have to just be all in and be ready to have your credit score wrecked.
You do. You have to tolerate some risk, to say the least. Yeah.
So the one question that everybody has is, it tastes so good. What's in there? So what's in there?
What's in there? It's actually pretty similar to ice cream, regular ice cream, except for we use skim milk, let's say, versus whole milk. We use, the biggest one is we use stevia, which is basically a zero-calorie, all-natural sweetener. We use organic stevia versus sugar. And then, I mean, that's pretty much the major stuff. We get a little bit smart with the fat content. Instead of using so many egg yolks, we use some egg whites, things like that. And it maintains the taste. And then what we do is we use really top-notch flavorings. And that's not just a selling thing, not puffery. It actually matters. In the early days, just trying like 20 different vanillas. Sure enough, the best stuff, the Madagascar stuff, just tastes so much better. It's noticeable.
As I said to you at the beginning, I have never actually tried Halo Top. I've I've heard about it, read about it, been very interested in the story, been very happy for LA because it's a huge LA success story, but I haven't tried it. So I'm going to try it now for the first time on camera.
Drum roll.
And if I don't like it, I'm going to tell people.
Okay.
I don't like
it.
So here we go. Okay, so I've got the peanut butter cup.
Yes.
It says, no bowl, no regrets.
Yes, we have a lot of cheeky little sayings on the top.
All right. Here we go. My first taste. I like the, it looks like ice cream.
That,
I guess it is
ice
cream.
That's a start.
Oh my gosh, delicious.
That's good, right?
And you're telling me, so this says 320 calories.
That's right, the whole thing.
I can eat the whole pint.
You can eat the whole pint.
That's 320 calories.
That's it. I always eat the whole pint, even if it's a pint that's 1,200 calories. So it's made for people like me.
And this doesn't have that sort of, people, you know, might say, oh, it has, it must taste sort of fake. It doesn't taste fake. It tastes, it's ice cream.
Yeah, I think until you try it, there's a lot of skepticism. I would probably be skeptical too myself.
Well, Justin, thanks for the free ice cream.
Very welcome.
Halo Top.
And, very welcome.
And congratulations on your success.
Thank you.
Thanks for being here.
Of course.
Thanks to Justin for a terrific conversation. If you'd like to hear the entire uncut version of our conversation, check out our podcast for Frank Buckley Interviews. It's available wherever you listen to podcasts. A new podcast drops every Wednesday. Thanks for the feedback on social media. If you'd like to join the conversation, I'm Frank Buckley TV on Twitter and Instagram, and there's a Frank Buckley Facebook page as well. Hope you enjoyed the program. Thanks for watching.